Hello once again, guys. Buzz Killington here, and for my last video of November, the Tacticus anyway, I thought I'd take a look at another character that I haven't given a tremendous amount of love to in the past, Aethana. Now, she does sound a little bit like a misfiring motorboat engine, see what I mean? But she's got skills, and she is actually pretty useful in the legendary event for Ragnar. As one of the requirements for one of the tracks, I think it's Alpha, is an all-flyer team, and Aethana, definitely a flyer, movement of 5. So, she was useful up until the early stages because she's abysmally low-leveled on my part, so I thought I'd have a quick look at her, see what her stats are like a little bit higher up. Have I been misjudging her, you know? Does she have more potential than I've been giving her credit for? So with that in mind, I've prepared a couple of infographics. But we're going to start off by having a quick look at her abilities at level 36. Starting with the passive, the Path of Command. So at level 36, friendly units within 2 hexes deal plus 135 damage, which isn't huge, but within 2 hexes, so not just ones that you're right next to, and their crit chance is increased by 20%. Eldari units deal an additional plus 101 damage, so Eldari are dealing 246 with an additional crit chance. So Path of Command does mean Aethana is pretty useful to have around, but the problem is you want her in the fray and not necessarily hanging back, helping other units boost themselves. So she's not necessarily always one to keep on the back line. So it's a little bit of a contradiction there. For that reason, I think the Path of Command is useful. It can have its place in things like Guild Raid, but maybe not the best passive overall, although I'm open to being persuaded otherwise, of course. It's the active where Aethana excels. So at level 36, which I think is always a good level to get things up to, as a Swooping Hawk, she flies over and deals a wave of damage from an initial melee target up to 2 behind. Looking at the damage there, 1213 for the first target. And of course, at 80%, pierce ratio, you're looking at 960, nearly 1,000, maybe around 1,000 of direct damage to that first target. So that is pretty damn effective. Not to mention all the additional piercing damage done to the targets behind. So yeah, pretty strong, and certainly I think a bit more useful offensively than her passive. So this is, you want to get her in, maybe keep her back, give a boost to the troops, then fly her forward, trigger her active. You can do a lot of damage to units that maybe have already been weakened by the volleys of fire from your other characters. Bear in mind, of course, movement of 5, there aren't many points on the battlefield that Aethana can't get to with maximum efficiency. Okay, so another quality Buzz Killington infographic. And thanks to one of my guildmates who pointed out that it's useful to put the actual pierce type of damage and a percentage of armor piercing it does. So obviously piercing damage, 80%. So, you know, she hits hard. She is pretty good against armored targets. This is at gold 1, 2100 health, armor 453. So very much a glass cannon. So maybe at this stage she benefits from being kept back. Damage 374 per hit, of course. So that's over 1,000 damage with 80% pierce ratio. It is pretty respectable, and I think at this level she's definitely good for legendary events. She's going to take out a lot, pretty much anything in one shot. Some more heavily armored targets and higher health targets she might take a little bit longer to deal with, but she is ideal for things like Necrons, Chaos Terminators. She just strips the armor away like it's nothing, and against lightly armored or non-existently armored troops like demons, she will take them out in no trouble at all. So on that basis, she's pretty good. I mean, if you want to do unlock Ragnar, I think leveling Aethana just a little bit is definitely useful. I did unlock Ragnar, I got him this time around, but I am going to want to level him up. So I think getting Aethana to gold 1 is definitely going to help me in that regard. Next up, of course, no showcase would be complete without looking at diamond 1 levels. And again, it's a steep jump, isn't it, from gold to diamond. Takes a while to get there, but when you get there, it's worth it. 4,000 health, 892 armor. Armor, she's still a little bit squishy, but a lot tankier than she was. So at Diamond 1, if you were to get her that high for Legendary, there's very little that could touch her early on, and you'd be basically cleaning up through a lot of the stages. Damage 734 per hit, so around 2200 with a pierce ratio of 80%. You're looking at around 1700, 1800 damage, which again is going to take out pretty much anything that she comes up against, especially if it's been weakened beforehand. So yeah, like, Aethana is one I've never had much time for, but on the basis of the gold and diamond stats, I think she's worth sinking a few resources into. Okay, so there you have it, guys. A brief look at Aethana in the light of the Ragnar event. As I say, I think she's got her uses. I mean, obviously, in this particular event, she's going to be needed. But I think overall, there's probably some potential here for future legendary events as well. So I'm going to be pushing her a little bit higher. Might get her to gold one. I'm not sure if I'm going to sink energy into her active and passive at the moment due to the horrifying lack of badges that I have. I have a horrifying lack of Xeno's badges, so really not going to be able to invest in her until I recover those numbers just a little bit. But yeah, I think at bronze 2 is a waste. I think getting to gold 1 at a very minimum is going to stand me in good stead, and I would suggest it might be worth doing the same as well, if of course you are so inclined and if you've got her already. As you can see, she's pretty high leveled. I've got a lot of shards for her. There is potential to level her higher. But of course, with only 7 legendary Xenos orbs, other characters are going to come first. But yeah, so that's it as far as my character showcase goes. Let me know in the comments, what do you think about Aethana? Do you think I've been fair? Do you think I've not been fair enough? Do you think I've misjudged her? Do you think I'm over-egging her? Putting more into her than she perhaps needs to have? And of course, feel free to let me know how you got on in the legendary event. Did you succeed in unlocking Ragnar? If not, how close did you get? Do you think you're going to get him next time? All right, thank you very much for watching. Until next time.